My name is Luka. I live on the second floor. I live upstairs from you. Yes, I think you've seen me before. If you hear something late at night, some kind of trouble, some kind of fight, just don't ask me what it was. Just don't ask me what it was. Just don't ask me what it was. I think it's 'cause I'm clumsy. I try not to talk too loud. Maybe it's because I'm crazy. I try not to act too proud. And they only hit until you cry. And after that, you don't ask why. You just don't argue anymore. Just don't argue anymore. You just don't argue anymore.
The thing that attracted me about the acoustic guitars is the thing that still attracts me. It's very mobile, it's very independent, it's very minimalistic. You're on stage with your guitar, and sometimes I'm on stage without my guitar. I'm just on stage with my voice. And I think there's something very powerful in one person sort of standing up and telling a story. And that, to me, has its root in the folk tradition. But the thing is, there are other people who take that tradition and push it a little farther, and they combine it with technology, and they combine it with, you know, other kinds of cultures, and it becomes more than just folk music. It becomes sort of the root of the folk music combined with other influences to make it broader and to push the boundaries of it and the limits of it. And I think that's what I'd wanted to do, was take some of the ideas of punk and rock and roll and minimalism and apply them to the sort of folk root and push the boundaries.
She's clearly coming from that New York group of artists that includes Lou Reed, Laurie Anderson, and so forth, but she's being accepted in the same way that Sade is. Now, that may sound like a bizarre comparison, but it isn't. They're both cool artists who have something to offer but aren't threatening. And they're appealing to the compact disc buying, album buying people.
The songs she wrote in her teens, which she still plays, are certainly very easy to listen to.
You come from far away with pictures in your eyes. Coffee shops and morning streets and the blue and silent sunrise. But night is the cathedral where we recognize the sign. We strangers know each other now as part of a whole design. Oh, me like a baby that will not fall asleep. Curl me up inside you.
My taste in music changed radically after my first rock and roll concert, which was, I went to see Lou Reed when I was 19. Before that, and it was a drastic turning point, although I didn't realize it until looking back on it. The first song I wrote after that I saw that concert was Cracking, which to me was the first song that really felt like a mature style to me, I guess. I suddenly felt like I could write songs that had an edge to them. I could use the language in a way I hadn't thought of doing before. I could use the words for how they sounded as well as what they meant. And I started thinking about vowels and consonants in a whole different way, and I started to think of my voice as an instrument, which I hadn't really done before. And suddenly it seemed more important to make the images clear and hard as opposed to sort of soft and flowing.
It's a one-time thing. It just happens a lot. Walk with me and we will see what we have got. My footsteps are ticking like water dripping
from a tree, walking, a hare lying, and stepping very carefully.
The narrator is going for a walk in the park, and through the details reflected in the landscape, you can see that this person is cracking, not the ice on the sidewalk. It's the person that's cracking, and that's the important thing. And so I guess what I tried to do with that song was write, put the kind of details in that a person who was cracking would write. And so from the very first line, which is, it's a one-time thing, it just happens a lot, you know you're talking to someone who's not making sense.
And something is cracking. Sidewalk, brittle branches in the air, the sun is blinding, dizzy golden dancing green, through the park in the afternoon, wondering where the hell I have been.
All her songs are influenced by the city of New York, where she grew up.
I spent the first 5 years on East 109th Street, which is Spanish Harlem. I don't remember a lot about that area, except that it was mostly black and Puerto Rican and Irish.
She's continued to live in New York and was soon drawn to Greenwich Village with its thriving folk music scene. Her successes there, notably at the legendary Folk City, finally persuaded her to move into the area.
I can't imagine Suzanne Vega coming from any city other than New York, because her songs are informed by everyday life in New York City and also the cultural influences that people of her age and interests are exposed to. All of the galleries in New York, all of the cinemas that show the foreign films all over the city. I can't imagine somebody outside of New York wanting to write about Marlene at this point, much less the enigma of Caspar Hauser. I think somehow there is a bit of the beat of the city in her music. The fact that she would write about the fancy poultry, a butcher, in a very New York way, a very direct way.
In the meat market in near where I live, there are all the signs of you know, what people are selling, usually parts of the body, of whatever animal it is. So you have breasts and hearts and livers and, you know, smoked tripe and this kind of thing. And it's very evocative because there's all these sort of sensual undertones to it, because you are talking about parts of the body. But in the meantime, you're here in this deserted place and with all the steel and cold metal, with this sort of remnants of warm living things that have been there, you know.
Fancy poultry parts sold here, breasts and thighs and hearts. Backs are cheap and wings are nearly fancy poultry parts sold here, breasts and thighs and hearts. Backs are cheap and wings are nearly fancy poultry parts sold here.
So you have the sound of poultry and sold. They both kind of complement each other, and then you have breasts and thighs and hearts, and so the whole thing works together neatly. But it's not only just about the parts, it's obviously about the way the words sound when they're together and their other meaning. You know, they're more human functions. Or I was thinking of, and wings are nearly free. Obviously, I'm not talking about poultry parts there. I'm talking about a metaphor.
Backs are cheap and wings are nearly free.
A hard, cold, inflexible environment, and then the feeling of struggling things, struggling live things like plants and children and animals and people. That's one thing about a city that for some reason has always fascinated me. One thing that fascinates me about being a single person in the city is that feeling of anonymousness that you always have, no matter what city it is, whether it's Tokyo or New York. There's that feeling of being one of a crowd, which is both very comforting to me and also very can make you feel very lonely. But one of my favorite things to do is to go into a diner or someplace like that and eat by myself.
I am sitting in the morning at the diner on the corner. I am waiting at the counter for the man to pour the coffee, and he fills it only halfway. And before I even argue, he is looking out the window at somebody coming in. It is always nice to see you, says the man behind the counter to the woman who has come in. She is shaking her umbrella, and I look the other way as they are kissing their hellos, and I'm pretending not to see them, and instead I pour the milk. I open up the paper, there's a story of an actor who had died while he was drinking. It was no one I had heard of, and I'm turning to the horoscope and looking for the funnies when I'm feeling someone watching me, and so I raise my head. There's a woman on the outside looking inside. Does she see me? No, she does not really see me, 'cause she sees her own reflection, and I'm trying not to notice that she's hitching up her skirt, and while she's straightening her stockings, her hair has gotten wet.
I don't know why. Why do I like places like this? I think because it makes me feel included, because anyone can come in here and eat and pay their money and sit at the counter and drink their coffee, and you're included. You have a place to go.
More than what the songs are about, it's the way they're constructed that has earned her most praise.
I like my lyrics to scan well. I like them to be concise and to... I hate repeating myself. I don't like there to be any fluff or extra stuff or any decorations or any cheap rhymes or... I mean, I try not to go for that. I try and look at a song the way I would design something. And this may be a kind of an odd story, but when I was in sixth grade, I remember I had a teacher who had built a pyramid out of these straws, and he put all of his weight on the top of the pyramid, and it held up. And he said it was because it was perfectly designed. And for some reason, that image made a lot of sense to me. And I thought, well, I would really like to write songs. First of all, I'd like to be that way, so I could withstand any kind of stress. You know, I'd like to have sort of my internal structure to be designed like that, so it could take any kind of stress. But I try and write my songs the same way.
I think her lyrics are actually quite subtle. She doesn't spell it out. And I think this is a great irony, because I'm sure that a lot of people are buying her album and just putting it on in the background because it sounds nice, when in fact, to get full value from it, you've got to study it. I'm sure there are hundreds of thousands of people who heard Luka on the radio, for example, and were not aware that it was about child abuse. You've got to really pay attention there.
Yes, I think I'm okay. I walked into the door again. Well, if you ask, that's what I'll say. And it's not your business anyway. I guess I'd like to be alone, with nothing broken, nothing thrown. Just don't ask me how I am. Just don't ask me how I am. Just don't ask me how I am. My name is Luka. I live on the second floor. I live upstairs from you. Yes, I think you've seen me before. If you hear something late at night, some kind of trouble, some kind of fight, just don't ask me what it was. Just don't ask me what it was. Just don't ask me what it was. And they only hit until you cry, and after that you don't ask why. You just don't argue anymore. You just don't argue anymore. You just don't argue anymore.
There are definitely some chords that attract me more than others. And you don't hear a lot of my songs sort of starting happily with a very resolved chord that sounds like everything is just cheerful and everything's going to work out fine, like this kind of thing. I did more when I was, say, 14 or 15 years old. That's the first songs I had was very much kind of major E chord kind of thing. But the ones that have drawn my attention lately tend to be unresolved. They're not really sad, they're not really happy, they're just sort of unresolved, and they tend to hang in the air, and that's the way I think about them, is like that. If you wanted to make that chord sad, you'd go, and this would give it a very sad and melancholy feeling, but as it is, it's just unresolved. Today I am a small blue thing, like a marble or an eye. With my knees against my mouth, I am perfectly round. I am watching you. I am cold against your skin. You are perfectly reflected. I am lost inside your pocket. I am lost against your fingers. I am falling down the stairs. I am skipping on the sidewalk. I am thrown against the sky. I am raining down in I'm scattering like light, scattering like light, scattering like light. I think that the images in my songs have that feeling of abstraction and color and shape, because in my mind, what I'm trying to do with an audience is make it as clear as possible for them to understand. Which, to some people, to me, I feel like what I'm doing is becoming more specific. Other people complain that I'm becoming too general and too abstract, and that it's not specific. Like that if Small Blue Thing is a love song, then why don't I say I love you instead of Today I'm a Small Blue Thing? Like, what do I mean by this? And why don't I just come straight out and say what I mean? When actually what I mean is, today I am a small blue thing. That's what I mean to say. It's more like I was really playing with that song. It was like a playful kind of thing. It was like, if this feeling had a shape, what shape would it be? Well, it would be round and cool and smooth. And then I thought, well, isn't that funny? That's sort of something like a four-year-old might say. And then I took a little further.
The song which introduced Suzanne Vega to the British public and gave her her first hit single here is about Marlene Dietrich.
Basically, Marlena, the Marlena that is referred to in the song, is a picture of Marlene Dietrich that was on my wall at one time. And it's sort of like if she were watching the comings and goings of that go on in my room, what would she think? And actually, I remember thinking, and see, there's all these private references that, to me, make it not one of the best songs I've ever written. So I was kind of surprised by the response to it.
It's a song she's performed most often and in most ways.
Even if I am in love with you, all this to say, what's it to you? Observe the blood, the rose tattoo of the fingerprints on me from you. Other evidence has shown that you and I are still alone. We skirt around the danger zone and don't talk about it later. Shop with a sawdust drone. Don't give away the goods too soon is what she might have told me. And I tried so hard to resist when you held me in your handsome fist and reminded me of the night we kissed and of why I should be leaving. Marlena watches from the wall. The mocking smile says it all. She records the rise and fall of every soldier passing. The only soldier now is me. I'm fighting things I can't. Her mocking smile says it all as she records the rise and fall of every man who's been here. But the only one here now is me. I'm fighting things I cannot see. I think it's all my destiny that I am changing, 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 changing. My final watches from the wall. Her mocking smile says it all as she records the rise and fall of every soldier.
Marlene on the Wall made her well known, but also left her wondering at the reasons for her sudden international success.
One thing that I think is a little strange is I wonder whether one of the reasons I've become successful in foreign countries is because I'm perceived as being somewhat old-fashioned or sort of quaint or traditional. When actually in New York, I think I was perceived as being much more progressive and even not rebellious exactly, because you know you don't look at me and think, oh yeah, she's a rebel, but I think I was definitely perceived as being much more independent. And I'm sure some of that must have to do with the way I look.
The one problem that I have with Suzanne Vega is that I'm not really moved by her in the end. You know, Joni Mitchell, to mention the person with whom she's fallaciously compared, but Joni Mitchell could move you over something that actually was not very tragic. I mean, she could make turning 20 sound like a catastrophe. And she would deliver it in such a style where you were touched. And Suzanne writes almost in an intellectual manner. She's almost setting poems to music. And because her vocal style is also cool, the emotion is lacking. And I think what personally I like most about popular music is to be moved emotionally and intellectually.
See, and I see a certain irony in it, and in it myself. I hear my voice as being very cool and clear, and yet the things I sing about are very violent and fragmented, and a lot of them are ugly. And to me, that's a satisfying combination. If I were to sing about these ugly, brutal things in a very raspy, kind of falling apart voice, I think that would be very predictable. If I were to have my voice and sing about, you know, beautiful flowers or you know, I don't know, tranquility and peace of mind, I think that would also be very predictable. But what instead you have is a contrast, which to me works really well.
It's a funny situation. I mean, what am I to do with Lisa in the upstairs room and Joan and Martha too? I can't come down to breakfast because the plates have all been used and it's as crowded as a subway car and I think that you're confused. Well, I would wait at your station, but I do believe it's time that I went home. And I am at Black Widow Station, darling, and I've been waiting for your train. I am at Black Widow Station, darling, and I've been waiting for your train. But you've been too long, darling.